In this lecture, I'm going to talk about the potential applications of nanotechnology in the aerospace sector. So why do we need nanotechnology for aerospace? Anytime when we talk about aerospace applications, miniaturization is a critical feature. Anytime when we lift something to the near Earth orbit, it costs approximately $25,000 kilogram in logistic costs. The same kilogram, now when you try to lift it to distant planets like Mars, it costs 10 times more, $250,000 or so per kilogram. So it is important to miniaturize payload, whether it is electronics or communication instruments or sensors, whatever constitutes the payload. So that is miniaturization is very critical. The second issue is the energy needs, especially in space exploration. No matter where you go, there is no utility company sitting there, waiting for you, greeting you, with a plentiful power supply. It is left to you to generate your own energy. Mostly your energy source is, solar energy. So it is ideal to have all your payload as low power consuming as possible. This way you can have an efficient utilization of the meager resources that you get in planetary exploration. So the miniaturization and low power consumption are two key requirements in space exploration activities. These two areas can be served well from the advances that we see in nanoscience and nanotechnology. Another critical issue in planetary exploration, particularly when we look at something like Mars exploration, the time for communication signal to travel between Earth and Mars could be an order of 10 to 20 minutes. So that requires all decisions to be made autonomously at the planetary level, which requires basically very highly powerful computers, which could be the size of your laptop or even smaller. The future nanoelectronics systems being investigated by the nanotechnology community could serve that purpose. Nanotechnology also presents a whole new spectrum of opportunities to build device components and systems and architectures in for space exploration. For example, you can think of a network of ultra-small rovers or robots for planetary exploration. And so these micro rovers, they can hop, fly, burrow, they can do all sorts of things. And or you can think of a collection of micro spacecraft that can make a variety of measurements, nano sensors, hundreds of nano sensors that could be spread across a planet and connected wirelessly, and they can produce a, for example, planetary atmospheric composition map. So there are a variety of opportunities like that. Last but not the least is nanomaterials and composites for making the spacecrafts themselves. In some of the previous lectures that I talked about materials such as carbon nanotubes and graphene, these materials have been used by the community to make ultra lightweight but very high strength composites. So these composites could be used in the construction of future spacecraft. That could be a big advantage in terms of reducing the logistical costs of space launches. I mentioned briefly about sensors for planetary exploration. The gas sensors, again, in one of the lectures, I talked about gas and vapor sensors extensively. Those sensors could be used in a variety of scenarios in space exploration. Both at the launch level and also during the transit of the spacecraft to the planet, there could be reasons to worry about fuel leaks. The small sensors placed strategically across the spacecraft could help to do leak detection. So that is one possibility. And during re-entry period and other times, the spacecraft air quality monitoring could be done using those, you know, small sensors. Typically, these sensors have been made, as I talked about in my previous lectures, on silicon substrates or printed circuit board, you know, PCB-based, you know, substrates. We can also think of actually incorporating these sensors, you know, directly on astronaut suits. For example, you know, something like, you know, smart textile or E-TEXTILE, which stands for, you know, electronic textile. The flexible electronics or smart textile, there are a couple of different ways to achieve the goal. One is you can discreetly mount the sensors on the textile. And that is something that, you know, which has been done over a period of time. But now the new nano-based approach involves, you know, making the textiles themselves actually functional in terms of whether you're trying to do gas or vapor sensing or temperature sensing or strain or stress sensing. Some of the efforts that are going on to incorporate, you know, electronic components in the case of smart textile, that includes, you know, cameras, you know, which can serve like an eye or, you know, microphone like a ear, and temperature measurement, you know, just like the way your skin feels the temperature, you know, pressure gauge, and a gas sensor could serve like an electronic nose, and rudimentary, you know, computing functions like processors and memory and communication antennas and, you know, RFIDs. The output could be in the form of a, you know, display, or the sound in the form of a speaker. If you incorporate all these electronic components in your smart textile, then you would need some power source, energy source. So photovoltaic effect, you know, can be exploited with, you know, photosensitive panels on the textile itself. Batteries and supercapacitors could be incorporated in smart textile. So these are all the efforts, research efforts, you know, currently ongoing across the world. In this view graph, I'm showing a carbon nanotube readily incorporated on cotton fabric. And in the image that you see, which is labeled A, it is a cotton fabric, and the dark line that you see is in a carbon nanotube. But the image label B, you know, shows an actual cotton fabric, you know, with a carbon nanotube woven like a yarn. So this carbon nanotube cotton sensor yarn, it was exposed to ammonia, and it serves as an ammonia detector, and it was able to detect ammonia as low as, you know, 5 parts per million. Just as using textile as a platform, you can also use paper as a platform for a variety of electronic components. Why would you want to use paper? Besides leather, you know, paper is robust under cryogenic, you know, temperatures. So that is one reason to look at, you know, paper as a platform. In a number of studies have appeared showing the ability to fabricate gas sensors, biosensors on paper. Again, gas sensor has got applications in leak detection and detection of, you know, various gases and vapors of interest in planetary atmosphere. Biosensors, you know, could be used, you know, to monitor the water quality in the International Space Station or in any kind of crew vehicle. Biosensors, again, can be used to serve as a lab on a chip to do, you know, routine, you know, health checkup of astronauts. So people have also demonstrated, you know, fabrication of logic and memory devices on paper substrates for communication. You know, antennas have been fabricated on paper substrate, even supercapacitors to do energy storage. So these are all some of the electronic components that have been, you know, fabricated on paper. So the advantages of, you know, paper-based sensors include paper is flexible and bendable and foldable. It is biodegradable, is totally green technology. I mentioned the paper is robust at cryogenic temperatures. You can use roll-to-roll printing or inkjet printing. So in that sense, it's much cheaper than conventional solid-state devices. For biomedical applications, you know, since you want to avoid cross-contamination, you know, paper-based ones are ideal for single use, and you can just you know, disperse them. As I mentioned, you can fabricate gas sensors and chem bio sensors, and even, you know, strain gauges, all of these things, which can be, strain gauges can be used for, to detect structural defects and cracks, particularly, you know, structural health monitoring. Other applications of relevance to aerospace sector arising from nanomaterials and in nanotechnology include exploiting, you know, the field emission, you know, potential of materials such as carbon nanotubes and graphene. So wherever you need electron source, you know, particularly in instrumentation, there are a variety of spectrometers that are used in, you know, planetary exploration. For example, X-ray diffraction spectrometer. So typically, these portable instruments, you know, their size is about the size of a small photocopier. The reason why they are that big is because the X-ray source that you need is, you know, is fairly big. It could weigh as much as about 5 kilograms. It could be about anywhere from, you know, 20 to 30 centimeter tall and about, you know, 6 to 7 centimeters in diameter. But these X-ray sources could be miniaturized using nanomaterials such as, you know, carbon nanotubes and graphene, which are excellent field emitters. So these X-ray tubes, you know, could also be used for electric propulsion and traveling wave tubes. So the key advantages of the X-ray tubes using, you know, carbon-based materials is they consume very low power, you know, compared to the conventional thermionic emission-based X-ray tubes. And that also allows extended device lifetime. There is no heating involved, you know, when you use a cathode, you know, made of, you know, carbon nanotubes. It's actually called cold, you know, field emission. Much faster, you know, on and off switching at very low voltages. And you can also get, you know, much smaller spot size and higher, you know, performance. So these type of carbon nanotube and graphene based, you know, field emission based, you know, cathodes, you know, could be electron sources that can be used, you know, in the miniaturization of instruments and traveling wave tubes and electric propulsion systems in the future.